Conservation Commission meeting.
Tonight's meeting of the Conservation Commission is being recorded for RCTV Live. Comcast Channel 22 of Verizon 33. The video photographer for tonight's meeting is Alexander. Check www.rctv.org for more information and for replay times. You can catch me 3 times a week. Thank you.
Please, no. So we have about 9 minutes. Did you folks have an opportunity to review the order of conditions for 310 South Street?
Is that the one I...
I saw it in my email, but I did not have the opportunity.
Yeah, that's the one you had that.
The only comment I had on is in the findings, the first one, last sentence, needs a verb, is.
Find it.
Sticky crowd.
Well.
It's in the details.
Yep, it's in the details. Did you folks sign the sign-in sheet? Please do so. Thank you.
So where are we at with that? Say that again.
Findings. First finding. Last sentence. Is.
There is forest buffer between them.
Well, Mike, I thought you'd catch that.
Yeah,
I didn't read it.
As soon as I get Mike back, I'm feeling good. But
were there any other comments, folks? Okay. Do we have time for the ORAD, 116 Van Norden Road?
I think you do. If you want to, did anyone look and compare it to the plan? Make sure I got all the flags.
We did it here at the meeting. I did not look back at it, but we went through it in detail at the meeting.
I sent it to Jack, and
so.
I sent it to Norris Environmental.
Did you?
And I didn't receive any replies.
Right.
And I'll check again right now. So nothing came in on that.
I think that's the meeting I missed. Those are the flags on the other side of the screen that you checked.
Right.
Yeah.
Yep. But you'd been out on the site before.
I've been on the site. Did you move any of those?
No.
Okay.
No. They were okay. I just had them connect one to another one. Yeah, at the end. And
that front there.
Yep.
In terms of for 116 Van Norden, there's in the findings there's no mention of all the extra trash, debris, building in the back. I guess I'm just going to ask the question.
Well, wouldn't you do that? I mean, when they come in with whatever they're proposing, I mean,
you
that's
do that
say the same thing we tell the residents. This is just a line, right?
Yeah.
Okay. But in terms of
I mean,
the
you
finding,
could,
it's,
you could
it's
describe
an
it,
observation of
yeah.
current conditions.
I kept it simple.
Okay.
I
all
mean,
right.
sometimes
okay.
I don't even add that page. And I just keep it to the regular state form.
Okay.
But
all right.
No, I when I was writing it, I was pondering over whether
I'm
I should
sure
put that in or not.
Sometimes putting it in a formal document might make it more an obvious. I have to.
Does
deal
someone
want to
go
issue.
Over the flag? Here's the here's the latest raised plan. So, starting with A, which would be up by the street.
Yep.
I have A1 through A6.
Yep.
I have have B1 through B10.
Okay.
I have C.
Wait a minute.
So it goes B1 to B10, to 1E to AE.
Okay, so I just, as long as I'm mentioning all those flags, so it's, so B1 to B10, and then C1 through C5.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
And then, the D series would be, I started out with 0D, comma, 1D, through 10D.
Nine, through 8D.
I thought it was through 10.
No, there's no 9.
Yeah, but.
Let's see this.
Six, seven, eight, yeah, it goes 8 to 10.
That was 11.
Yeah.
8 to 10.
Oh, there is no 9. 1D through 8D.
Through 10D.
Through 10D. Okay, and then 13D through 28D.
Yep.
1E through 8E. Okay.
Okay.
But 1E connects to 10B.
Yeah, but 10B is mentioned in there, do you want me to write the, in the connecting things, that's what Mike was asking, he said I didn't connect the A series to the B series.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
That was a comment I had the last time.
Alright.
Yeah. Do you want a Cane's potato chip?
What?
Add that to your jail.
Cell jail?
Yeah, your cell jail.
I should add the cell jail to the potato chip.
That's great, yep.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Good luck.
Two minutes, do we have anything, do you have time for anything else?
Is that the room?
Yes.
Did.
I could just let you know that the artist, I sent out the violation notice for Artist Senior Living.
Yep.
And they were, de-watering into a storm drain on Ashley Place. And,
The storm drain was on Ash Place?
Yeah.
Ashley.
Where is?
Ashley?
Ashley Place.
So it's above the retaining wall and in the cul-de-sac area.
Oh.
So.
Is that up by?
It's behind it.
Yeah, it's directly behind it. So what ended up happening, I was told, and it might be more time than this, that the, de-watering operations started. We heard about it on Sunday, I got a letter on Monday, I believe, and then it went 4 days. And then as soon as, then it was stopped, after they received our letter, or I think it was 4 days prior to Sunday, and then it was stopped when I sent out the email on Monday, and, just about everybody on the team called and apologized, and they wanted to know if they were to come here tonight, but I did explain to them that the way our regulations work is that we have to start the process in order to get to the next step, and the next step would be fines. So that's why the violation notice went out, and we put them on notice that, you know, we're paying attention to what's going on out there. So we did get that original letter from a concerned citizen who didn't sign his name, so I don't know, or her name, so I don't know who sent it, but, followed up on it, and, the site superintendent wasn't there, and that might have been part of the problem. He's away on a vacation for the last couple of weeks, and they had some subs on the job, filling in for him.
Was this, I didn't go out there, was this a a trench or the actual foundation of the major structure they would award?
It was the pit for the elevator shaft.
Ah.
Yeah.
And when they stopped the dewatering to the storm drain, did they stop construction on that portion of the site?
Well, actually, I think that they were able to complete the job that they needed to do. So they did it long enough to get their work done.
No.
Yeah. So they're not allowed to work in Reading on Sunday. So, you know, nothing came apart of that part of it, but I did send it to the police department also.
So is it safe to assume they're not going to have any more dewatering?
Well, they're without having the proper structure.
No, I mean, do you think they'll need to do any more dewatering?
No, I wasn't informed that there was nothing else coming up. I believe there. It's a possibility.
So the enforcement order was just to stop the dewatering. There was no mention of any remedial action.
Right. It was just a violation notice, which only just lets everyone know that you know, we know that there's a problem on the site. You need to take care of it. I reminded them of where it's mentioned in the order of conditions, and I reminded them that there could be fines associated with this if this stuff continues.
And do we know where that storm drain discharges?
We don't. I don't.
Okay, we probably ought to check with engineering, find out where it discharges, and go down and take a look, see if there's any silt built up in the surface waters.
Okay.
Okay, having the time after 7:10, I'd like to have the request for determination of applicability for 2016-11, 2 Maple Street, map 16, lot 111. Mr. Hannon?
Hello.
Would you like to give us your proposal?
Sure, yeah.
Sure, introduce yourself. And
just pillars in the ground, you know, 50 inches down, just stone underneath them, and filled with concrete, 10-inch diameter, and yeah, that's it. Once those are in the ground, build the deck.
So, where do you plan to stockpile your material?
Stockpile the material for the deck, in the driveway.
Okay.
You mean the building material or the excavated material?
Where is the excavated material? It's
up against the house.
It's just up against the house, yeah.
Right. And are you using, did you use a bobcat to?
No, I did that by hand.
You dug that hole by hand?
Yeah.
It's pretty clean.
Wow.
Clean cuts.
Did you go ahead and look at it?
Yeah, we did site visits and we checked it out. I think what's curious is what's going on with that pipe there.
I thought the same thing. What was looks like it's extending towards the wetlands. It's filled with just dirt. It's completely packed full. And I ran back into the house into my basement, and it's not connecting to anything. So it's just kind of going through.
Was there
through
a septic field
it's
out
probably
there?
Probably an old leach field, and you're going to have to go to Board of Health probably and see if they have any documentation on it. If it hasn't been collapsed properly, probably needs to be. It needs to be collapsed, filled with sand under there.
The Board of Health, you said?
Yeah.
That'd be interesting.
When was your house built, approximately?
Interesting, because it's in the wetlands.
In the 70s, I'm saying.
So
we don't know. Your house is connected to the public sewer now, though.
Definitely.
And you don't know when that happened, do you?
No.
It says 1953.
It's
connected to
the house
sewer
was built
in 53?
Yeah.
I'm not gonna have any records of this.
Which, the connection or the building?
The, it says the building was built in 1953.
Yeah, the assessor's data is not gonna tell you.
They're not gonna have a cesspool.
No change like that, yeah.
No.
Several of us took an inspection, some on Sunday morning and the others Tuesday afternoon. And the edge of your lawn, right at the edge, just beyond, there's significant wetland vegetation, so we believe that that is the location of the wetland, which is not depicted accurately on this plan. And somebody else wanna add to that?
Yeah, so we actually, when we were out there yesterday, we actually taped off a few locations. We taped, it was, we did the corner of the house to the edge of the lawn. We did the corner of the, approximate corner of the deck, and we projected out where it would be to the edge of the lawn and then.
Is the edge of the lawn this, I assume?
No.
Property line?
It's not shown on the plan.
Yeah.
I don't know, it's hard to say.
What is it, Mike, what's it?
What is it, what's the distance?
It's 32 feet from the corner of the proposed deck is about where the skunk cabbage begins to grow. We've got 26 feet to the edge of the lawn from the proposed deck, corner of the proposed deck, and 36 feet from the corner of the house to the edge of the lawn.
But we don't know where the edge of the lawn is on this drawing.
Nor do we know where the wetland line is either. I guess the point is, under our bylaw, there is a 35-foot no structure, and it looks like you are within that 35 feet. It's not to say that you can't propose work, but you would have to get a variance. And a structure that close to a wetland, you would have to file a notice of intent. So, just so that you know that right up front.
Mm. Oh, I see that point.
Yeah, I see that point.
And also, I would strongly recommend that you hire a professional wetlands person to identify where that wetland line is. That's something that we would need. Anything else that we want?
Well, once we get the line, then we would need some, if not surveyed, at least a number of taped distances from that line to various points on the plan. And when you do get the wetland scientist, make sure he does take some soil samples and fills out all the logs.
Sure.
And if you need more information on notices of intent, you can go on MassDEP website,
okay.
and you could talk to Chuck, and he also has forms downstairs at the town hall.
Yeah. I do want to mention that I saw on the site visits some fresh yard waste, and it looks like a lot of previous yard waste is really plopped in an area that looks to be potentially wetlands within the buffer.
Yeah,
yeah,
that's like all the neighbors.
I'll
go in there
and dump it. Yeah, I was looking at
your
site.
Everyone goes in there.
Couldn't be all yours.
No,
yeah,
definitely not.
We figured
yeah.
that, but since it's your property, it's
yeah.
gonna it's your
is
issue.
Is it his property though?
No.
It's his drainage
it's
easement.
Not.
Oh.
I don't think it is.
But
don't
they have to go in through your property
they
to
have
get
to
that?
Yeah. Yeah.
So
I think they've mowed.
They do. It's
they've mowed onto the town land. So
oh, really?
That looks like his
oh.
property, but it's all.
It does.
So he's only about a foot or two
off the
his driveway.
Okay. Yeah.
And the rest
are
is.
Yeah, I mean, I have the plot plan now, so there is an iron stake on the other side of the property, so I can just stretch a line and see where it stops. But
the dumping of yard waste in there has to stop.
Yeah, I can put like a little sign up. no dumping.
Yeah, and we're probably going to, when you come back and do your thing, we're probably going to want you to clean that up, so.
Sure. Not on his property.
Well, we're going to ask. Doesn't have to,
well,
but we
you know
ask.
What that would take to clean that up? That's every neighbor for the last 50 years of
I didn't,
stuff.
I didn't walk over where Anika went,
yeah,
so I didn't see how big
this,
the pile
this
was.
Has been ongoing.
Several.
Yeah.
You know, 30-yard dumpsters.
It's
several
it's
30-yard dumpsters,
yeah.
You think?
There's a lot back there.
It's Pine Vale is one of the worst areas. Everyone who lives around Pine Vale thinks that that's their own personal dumping ground for all their yard waste, or most people, I should say.
Just out of curiosity, how did this, obviously the construction's already started, how did this come to our attention? Just out of curiosity.
I don't know how it was. Maybe it was a call, but I know I went down there and I looked, 8 months ago, and I think we started talking about 8 months ago, and it's taken a while to get this in, but it certainly hasn't done any work, you know, after we originally contacted the owner.
Well, what's the excavation?
I don't know what that's all about.
Oh. Cause that, I mean, that's larger than what you would put for Bigfoots.
Well, no, I think that's the Bigfoots, it's easier to just dig the trench.
Okay.
It was just a 10-inch, like, sawtooth, I would have went down with, like, an auger, but...
Does the water at the bottom worry you?
Required by law, it's easier just to trench it out so it doesn't collapse in.
Yeah, it seems like it's filled with water. I mean, groundwater is pretty close to the surface there.
There was a lot of rain, too.
Mm.
Yeah, it was raining that day when we went. Have you ever, Chuck, would it make sense maybe to help James by gathering an abutters list and send out some letters notifying people that that's an easement and it's not okay to dump there?
It's town land.
It's town land and it's within our jurisdictional area. That is something we've done in the past, and I think it's
James putting up a sign might help, but I mean getting a letter from...
Maybe from us.
We've blanketed the Pineville area once or twice before since I've been here.
Really?
Can the town put up the sign?
We put up one in Hunt Park.
Yeah, I mean, I think it'd be nice if for James to tell his neighbors that he's talked to us and he's heard this, but I don't think it's his responsibility to put up a sign.
No.
Yeah, I agree.
I mean, I can mention if I see it happen, I can mention it.
It'd be nice for that to happen, but it's certainly not your responsibility to police all your neighbors as well.
Well, Chuck, does engineering owe us any further mitigation, or?
No, the rest of it is...
The debt is paid?
We got rid of what we... We're owed a one or two up and dry pieces of land, and we're not giving that up.
What about from the high school stuff?
What's that?
What about
from the high school
stuff, light
the lighting.
But that's really not for the Nate.
Didn't
they
agree to
the
take
DPW
out some fragmites or something?
That's what it was.
Yeah, they already agreed to some mitigation,
yeah.
I think.
Yeah.
I was thinking like a fence is what I was thinking. Maybe we could put up a guardrail or a fence.
There's a path through there, if I remember correctly.
Yes.
So
where does the path go to, James?
The compost area?
I think it cuts through to Washington Park, maybe.
Private compost
does
area.
Might, I don't know. Some of those do, I don't know.
Okay.
I don't think that one does, but because you have to go over the brush piles to get
No, there's a nice corridor through them.
Actually, can you pull up the site on there?
This isn't working too well.
Yeah.
So I think that would drive everyone crazy.
Yep.
So I can't.
Okay, so let's finish putting James in the right direction. So
I think that we
engineer,
have.
Right,
is it?
Botanist. You need your wetlands line on this plan. You need some measurements from the new wetlands line to the corner of the deck, whether or not it's in or out of the 35-foot no-build zone. There's a 25-foot no-disturb and a 35-foot no-build. And we should know where both of those are on the plan you submitted to us.
Thank you very much.
I think that's it.
Thank you.
Is it Mrs. Dowdy? We signed your order of conditions.
Okay.
Okay, did you? You talked to Chuck about this afternoon, did you?
We traded a couple of emails, but I don't know what the ultimate, where we landed with.
Did you have any questions or concerns with the draft order?
Well, I think the only question was exactly what to use for erosion control, because I think we had a couple of different terms being given to me, and maybe it was just, I don't know if I was interpreting the right thing or if they were being used interchangeably or what, I think we had, on the plan, we had 12-inch mulch sock, so, and somebody, a supplier to me, described it as a fiber roll, which I thought was the same thing, but I guess it's not.
It's not.
So.
Are you clear on what we are requiring?
Well, we're, that's what I had in the plans, was the 12-inch mulch sock, so I'll just make sure that the supplier is using that.
Yeah.
So we're all set?
That's readily.
Yeah, that was, it was simple. I mean, that part of the order of conditions is, I can change that when I go out to the site and require different things, but the fiber roll, it just sounds like it's lighter. I don't think I've ever seen a fiber roll, but I've seen a lot of things, and I trust the mulch sock, and, you know, silt fence seems to be the best barrier. And they're going to be dismantling the garage pretty close to there, so I thought the mulch sock would work best.
Okay.
That's fine.
All right. Thank you. And now we have the request for determination of applicability for 118 Belmont Street, map 28, lot 120, Sperling, 2016-12. And would you introduce yourself, please?
Sure. Where would you like me to set up? Which side of the room? Is it over here?
Yeah. Yep, we, several of us met you.
I'm Bill McLeod from Andover Consultants, and I'm representing Adam and Amy Sperling. And this job actually started out as a swimming pool project, but got somewhat reduced down to a patio and redoing the lawn in the backyard. I understand that some of you may have had a site visit over the past few days to look at the backyard. And I'm sure you noticed that there was a row of tall hemlocks along the back. They're accurately shown on the plan, and between the existing lawn and the hemlocks is a low landscape retaining wall. So what we plan to do is take that retaining wall out, take out the shed that's there now. That shed is inside the no structure zone, so we'll remove that shed completely, just tear it down. And
is that shed on a foundation or just on cinder blocks?
I think it's just on
sonotubes.
Yeah.
Oh, it's on sonotubes.
Yes.
Are you going to take those out?
Yes. Yeah. I'll just wiggle them out of the ground. And the shed's been there for a while. It was there before Mr. Sperling bought the house. And then they'll construct a patio to give them a level area. That patio will be outside of the no structure zone. It's a brick patio on top of crushed stone.
So a patio with a deck where the shed was?
No. Well, the shed was actually closer to the wetland.
Okay.
So the patio area will be in an area that's partially some ornamental shrubs. As you saw, the lot is flat, so there's no regrading taking place. There's no heavy excavation taking place.
Where are the ornamental shrubs going?
Well, there were some ornamental shrubs over here.
Oh, and you're taking them with that?
And those would come out, and that's where the patio was going to go.
You didn't get out.
And then the new lawn will be outside of the 25-foot no-disturb zone. And the retaining wall would be removed from the 25-foot no-disturb zone also.
The back of yard is amazing. The plantings. Are you going to use some of the plantings and remove them? Because you have other new planting beds around the patio.
Yes.
So you're going to take some of that material and reuse that?
I think maybe some might be reused. There is a landscape architect involved that's going to be guiding plantings on site. Certainly, any new plantings would be native species.
Any new plantings would be native species.
Native species.
Can we include that as a condition, Chuck?
Yeah.
a question about the landscaping. Does the new lawn, is the new lawn area going to extend all the way to those large pines in the back?
No, oh no,
no,
not at all.
It's only gonna go to
It's gonna go
the hay bale line?
To where the hay bale line is, again, the 25-meter. And we kept the hay bale line on the 25-foot line, knowing that that's what your regulation is.
Part of that shed is down gradient from the hay bale line. Let's just make sure that when you're digging at the sonotubes, we have erosion control on the downhill side of the site work.
Good point, Jamie.
You follow me, Chuck?
We could add, we could certainly, before they take the shed down, just add some
Sure.
additional on that down slope side.
That's all we're at, that's all I'm at.
So, I'll just ask, so there's a vernal pool to the southeast, southwest. Is that 120 feet? I guess I'm wondering, how was this, that line, almost a contour line?
How was that done?
Yeah.
I actually went out and measured it myself. So I got the water level of that pool at high water in March.
You did? Okay.
And did you survey it in?
Yes, I took tape measurements from control points and wetland flags that we had already surveyed, so. And that was only because I discovered it on the database after we had done the survey, much to my chagrin. But it's on the it's on the natural heritage map.
Okay. So we went out there, we did do a site visit, I think the only thing we noted was to us it seemed like a wetland flag 5A should probably be moved towards the shrubs, toward the backyard, about 5 feet.
Mm-hmm.
That was our opinion out there at the time on Sunday.
This is an RDA though, correct? So.
Right.
Well, I think it's important to note that we're not necessarily
certifying
that line.
Well, it is part of our practice on every permit to verify the resource area boundary.
Yeah.
So.
And I think, but from a point of, because I know we did this recently, Chuck, we talked about this, I think.
Right.
Yes.
So,
was the,
so typically, if it was a GIS survey or a survey done 10 years ago and it was modified by the homeowner to put on his plan, we wouldn't verify the wetland line. And so there's actually a check off inside the RDA to make sure that happens. And I typically do that unless it's presented by a consulting firm and it was surveyed in by a wetland scientist. So this one, you know, can or can't be at science. It's on that, right on the line. I guess it would have been approved if this didn't come up. I guess in order to just kind of keep moving along, it doesn't really matter for this project.
Yeah, I don't think it makes a big impact on the backyard. Just for part of our notes.
How far is any activity from the vernal pool? How far is the patio from the vernal pool?
About 90 feet. But again, all the activity is really taking place in already disturbed ground, so any of the activity is taking place in areas that's not habitat.
Well,
it's already lawn area, it's landscape beds, it's walks, it's where the shed is.
You're taking that wall out though, right?
We're gonna take
right.
out that wall,
mm-hmm.
yes.
And that's closer than 90 feet.
It is.
How high is that wall?
The wall is a raised
wall.
Oh, okay.
It's a landscape feature wall.
Stacked stone.
Right, like 6 inches maybe.
Yeah.
Is that fill behind it?
No.
No.
Okay,
it's like a raised bed.
Decorative.
When written down, it appears to be a substantial structure, but it's really not.
In our surveys, we tend not to leave anything not shown on the existing conditions plan. So some people might not have even shown it on their survey, but we did.
I don't have any issues.
I think it's a pretty thorough plan, it looks pretty good.
I think I have one last question. The fence type and what type of fence and what's it made of?
The landscape architect discussed a metal type fence, one that may be black that just blends in. So it's one that isn't truly visible, but Mr. Sperling wants the fence in the backyard so that his children can have a safe place to play. And we're making sure that the bottom is at least 4 inches above the ground so that it's not a hindrance to wildlife travel.
It's going to be a vinyl coated galvanized chain link fence?
Is that what you're going to use?
I think that's the plan, yeah.
So one more, Anika, didn't we see some dumping there as well? Wasn't it a landscaper? Weren't there two or three small piles when we were
small
out beyond those trees? Small enough we're not worried about?
Yeah, there were.
I mean, it'd be easy enough just to throw it in the water to just clean them up by hand.
Yeah, I mean, if there were any small piles.
Well, on the other side, and it looked like on the walkway where you walked around the trees on the
past
existing
the
deck, it looked like a landscaper probably
somewhere
before you bought it, or somebody was.
And I have somebody come every week to.
And they take it with them.
And they take it away.
Yeah, so it's probably maybe before you bought it. But there are a couple small piles there. If the landscaper comes, if you could just have him grab them and,
we can do
and
that,
get them out of there by hand, that'd be great.
Behind the
hemlocks.
Behind the hemlocks, the tall hemlocks.
Towards the
remember where the yellow flowers are?
Yes.
Yes.
Sort of in that area, there's one
little
pile there.
Oh, yeah, I can
have
clean that up.
Just to the left of that, there's, I think, two
piles.
Yeah. They're not huge, but... You know, if you're there working, you might as well just
easy enough
clean
to
it
take
up.
It away.
A couple wheelbarrows.
Be done.
Besides that, I think it's good.
I don't have any further questions.
Are there any questions from the audience or the public? Hearing none.
I did prepare the order of conditions, and I...
Order of conditions or the determination
of applicability.
Don't we need to make a motion?
We do.
Yeah.
Okay.
I'll make a motion for a negative determination. With as amended, we include that we weren't going to verify the wetland line as shown on the current plan and
the additional erosion control around the shed
During removal.
And do you have only native plants?
Only native plants.
So we're not verifying, that was already in here. So it's the additional hay bale on the downhill side of the shed, and new plantings must be native.
And removal
minor,
of the small.
Minor cleanup.
And you want the cleanup.
Second.
All those in favor? Okay.
All set.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank
checking
you.
Off in three. If you remember that.
So, Chuck, this is ready to be signed?
Yeah, it just has those two minutes. It
okay.
doesn't.
Yeah, we can sign it.
Take care of that.
No,
you're all set.
You might
send
have
this
to.
Out to you tomorrow.
Before you go, you might have to write us all a check.
There's there is a 10-day appeal period, and this will come with some instructions where a pre-activity meeting has to take place before any work can be done.
Okay.
But just wait.
You don't want to check?
You were listening.
Right.
He's making his debut.
Yeah, wasn't it? That was beautiful back there.
Okay.
She was the president of the garden club.
What did you?
I forget. We should have asked. But I would have took that shed instead of that pad and turned it into a playhouse for the kids.
Yeah.
He was looking for
that shed
spots for the kids.
Shed.
Huh?
That was hard to remove.
Shed, yeah.
That was a 10 by 20 shed. That
yeah,
thing
was
yeah. I thought that backyard was off the charts. Yeah.
whatever.
Different taste. Trying to get rid of the lawn out there, but I hate.
Really? Oh, the shed, it's just.
That yard's a lot of work.
Oh, yeah.
I'll tell you.
Okay.
Okay. Next on the agenda is a request for determination of applicability for 2016-10, 16 Nugent Lane, map 46, lot 68.
Hi, I'm Dave Nugent. I filed the RDA to remove 10 trees that are in around a wetlands area. They're actually endangering the home. Over the past, we built the street, and I think I occupied the house in 93. They weren't that big. Now they're big. And they are shading the house. We're getting a lot of ice damage during the winter time. No shade. The house is not melting out. Put a lot of copper up there to help melt the property away. A lot of damage as the trees are starting. Some of the bigger pines are breaking off and falling on the house and on the cars. And they're fairly close to the home. So that was for the impetus of this application.
We took a inspection. There were two groups, Anika, Al, myself on Sunday morning, and then Amy, Mike, and
Harry
and Chuck on Tuesday evening. We were a little confused at how many trees we thought we saw 9. These guys saw 10 with the X's on it. But your application starts with, goes from 9, then to 10, then to what? Mr. Moses's write-up was 11. And I think Chuck explained to me that one of them had a double trunk.
Yeah, it's
a twin.
Yeah, a twin. So on the walkthrough yesterday, Bob brought that up. It's in danger. It's diseasing or becoming diseased in the middle of the tree.
Mr. Moses, are most of those trees in bad shape? They didn't. Some didn't look it to us.
Well, as I'm Bob Moses. I'm a Massachusetts arborist here and performing for quite a while in the local areas of arboriculture. And as far as to answer that question, as you folks that did the site visit noticed that the trees are all in sunken land, and the elevation of the house is probably about 7 or 8 feet higher. So when you have trees that are down in a more saturated area, the root structure is always compromised and always in danger of failure. Always in danger of the anthracnose, which is a root disease, because of the wetness, which is always there. Most of the trees that are slated to come down are conifers, which don't have taproot. Conifers have surface roots. Deciduous trees have a taproot that goes straight down to give it a better structural integrity. So when talking about shape and condition, trees can have a full crown of leaves, needles, but the opportunity to have damage from wind and the elements is greater, especially when you add in that it is sunken down to a lower land area. The tree that we considered two, which was a red maple, has what's called an included or common bark crotch, and I was explaining to the folks out there the other day with a two branch, the two leaders meet, there's no bark in between, and that tree is definitely in danger of failure. I dug out with my hand into the crotch where they two come together, and there's definitely compost and rot in there. And my concern with that is when the other big trees are gone, it's going to be more apt to become a flag in the wind and more apt to failure.
Mm-hmm.
And most commonly included bark crotches are the more visibly in our field, the ones that do come down in windstorm damage, and they split at the crotch down low. It endangers not only his house, but the abutter's house. The other thing that I noticed when I was there is that there is a whole bunch of mold and mildew on the house. He's already had to replace boards, some fascias, some clapboard. there's just no sunlight filtration in there. It's just not healthy for the dwelling itself. And nothing makes that go away except sunlight. I mean, he's actually, it's like a rainforest in there.
Okay.
Do we know approximately where the resource delineation or the wetland line is?
Did you have an idea, Chuck?
It's
closest
area. We wrote those down. Was it 20? They're all within 25 feet of the stream.
Of, yeah, of the stream and of the house.
And they're also within 25 feet of the house. Yeah. So if you were out there with an auger, which we didn't have, it's probably going to be closer to 15 feet of the resource area, which is further away from the house. They're all pretty much 25 feet or closer to the house. And then that double trunk tree was probably like 30 feet from the house.
Was that double trunk tree kind of off the patio area?
No,
to the left
when you're
of the house?
When you're on the crossing, as you make the bend, right, when you're coming towards my house, my brother's on the right hand side,
mm-hmm.
It's actually inside that bend, right in front of the house.
That one, I think, was we actually
there
measured it was about 50 feet from the house. I think it was 25 feet from the last, the only one that, so there's one tree that had paint on there in this area.
It's near the drive-in?
Yeah.
I remember that. Yeah. That's big.
And
yeah.
Then, so there's the double trunk is actually about 25 feet closer to the resource area, possibly. Did we say, was it in it or right on the edge?
I don't,
just outside? I forget that one.
That was probably five feet, I think
five
I said.
5 feet outside,
yeah.
And 50, but it we measured 50 feet.
I think 50
house.
Feet, yeah. Because
it was
50
and 25 for those two.
Can I ask
just gonna measure it right now.
If you were to get a permit to remove these trees, how would you go about it?
Setting up a crane, we would cross over the culvert. I took some real tight measurements. Crane outriggers will stretch out properly. We'd have a climber in each tree that we take down. So the only
third,
thing.
A third, a third.
Pretty much.
Something like that.
Some of those pines are pretty big. It might be a little more than a third, but we'd pick them and we'd send them out into the street.
So your crane would be on Nugent?
Yes.
And it would go over?
Over the house.
Over the house and
oh,
over
no,
the,
not
the,
to
the forest.
No, no, no. We're going to be in his
driveway.
Oh, okay.
All right.
Yeah,
we would set up in his driveway. Climber would be in the tree. There'd be nothing going into the wetlands at all, you know, except for foot traffic. And we would be picking the trees and sending them out towards the end of his driveway.
How big are those pine trees?
Some of them are 80 and 90 feet.
And these, you said, have grown up since you built the house?
Oh, yeah.
Remember,
so
you're in a very wet area, and all conifers do suck in about, you know, many thousands of gallons of water per week, and they grow about 3 feet a week. 3 feet a year is the norm for
24 years ago.
Yeah.
I was gonna say,
so
23 years ago.
Now, it seemed to me if you go down the driveway and you go to that patio area to the left of the house. There were like three trees spray painted in that area. It seems to me those are quite possibly the farthest from resource area. Is that what you guys found on your site visit too?
Yes.
Yep.
So do you know the rough distance of those?
I think those were 40. Go back to that.
Can I ask a question? Chuck, you know the cherry tree I showed you that was grown up through the other three. I might have to take that oak leader off.
Yeah.
Are those the furthest away from the resource area?
Those would be, yeah.
Those would be.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Those
so
are
what,
right
what Anika's talking about is not that group. She's talking about the ones that are kind
on
of in front
side.
Of them.
Yeah. So it's around the back side of the house. It's on the side of the house, but almost in line with the back.
Okay.
It's that tree
down.
That was angled and almost falling down.
It was like a group of three.
Stuck in another tree.
Yes, intertwined into another tree. You're talking about you may have to take a limb down from
right,
one
to
or
get,
the other
to get
one.
Clear access to that, yeah.
Those were about 40 feet.
If
and
you folks did have the opportunity to walk down in, like I was when you guys were there, you will see that there are a lot of leaders that have fallen, and there were a couple of trees, smaller caliber stuff, ten-inch, twelve-inch stuff that has uprooted and fallen, so, you know, it's just, it comes with the territory of wet areas like that, you know, with surface root trees.
So that area where most of these trees are, it doesn't look like you're using that for any recreation or anything, you wouldn't be doing anything with any of the roots?
No, I mean, the kids have run around there, when they're a little run around there, yeah.
You take it down to 10 feet or something?
Just trying to get some relief for yourself.
I just need to get the shade off that.
So how much would you leave from the ground up?
We normally would flush cut the stumps, you know.
Is that what's proposed?
Yeah.
Because we had talked about, you know, I'd asked these folks when Amy and Mike and Chuck were out about, you know, if it was required to grind the stumps. Not that I would even think about grinding stumps in there, because stumps are a natural habitat for insects and animals and stuff. Normally, in most of the communities I work in, unless it's allowed, they're usually left. But if you're asking, are they going to be left at a certain height, I guess my question would be, what are your thoughts for that?
I don't know, generally we 8 or 10 feet or something, right? Have we done that in the past?
Some sort of stand that won't cause harm to the house.
For what reason?
Just what you just said, habitat.
Wildlife habitat.
On every tree?
On ones in the resource setback.
So it would be, the problem is with the conjoined tree, that's where you reach down.
That would have to come right down, that would have to be flush cut.
Yeah.
The big pine up front, that's not a big deal.
Right. One of my concerns with the ones closest to the house would be carpenterians and termites, and the fact that they do fly.
Right,
and normally carpenter ants go after termite shells in the trees. So I'd worry about those being left up, because that would be a breeding area which would not be good for his house. Maybe the ones further away, I mean, it's your call. I'm just giving you my professional opinion.
Well, you saw the big maple. There's a big maple there that was fine and got diseased and then dropped across Nugent Lane, actually towards the house they grew up in. And that was a result of insect infestation, which you can see. I didn't touch it. It's sitting there, and it's deteriorated over the years. It just fell down one day. So I don't want that happening. So anything around the house that's 20 feet off the edge, I'd like to take it down, no flesh cut. If you want something that's up, the bigger trees that are up, you're closer to
the stream.
The stream, and that's fine by me.
Can I ask a question? For those of you that were on the site visit, which is everybody but me, was the area under those trees lawn?
No.
Shrubs or just
forested wetlands? No, actually, pine duff.
So when those trees come down, that's going to change.
There's a whole bunch of saplings in there.
You'll have more growth in there.
Yeah.
I want the growth.
I think it's going to stimulate. I think it's going to be a positive thing.
I think that I would agree with you, except could be fertile ground for invasive species to come in, such as Norway maples.
I didn't see any Norway maples in there to begin with. The maple tree that's compromised with that cotton included Bob Crotch is a red maple. I don't even remember seeing any Norways in there. And Norways, you're 100% correct, they do, you know, grow from, you know, sapling from seed. I don't recall seeing any in there.
Well, we are trying to formulate and be consistent with a tree replacement policy.
Or tree cutting policy, isn't it? What's it called?
When we have trees removed within a certain distance of the wetland, we ask for one-to-one replacement.
So it's a request?
Yes, and it's not the same size, obviously. And maybe instead of, you know, invasive species, maybe that could be a suggestion of red maples. And Mr. Moses, in your opinion, would that eliminate the Norway maples perhaps coming in?
My particular opinion would be to put ground cover shrubs, and we talked about this, such as blueberry, because you want things to spread down there that are going to keep other trees from growing up through. Now, he's trying to eliminate larger trees growing, as he said, in the 20-something years. you know, it's a very fruitful, rich environment in there for things to grow. I don't think he's gonna want trees in there.
No.
I think he'd rather do, you know, on request, some, you know, blueberries or something that's gonna be lower ground cover. There's a whole bunch of other small trees, pines and
aspen
saplings in there. There's a whole bunch of other stuff in there. This isn't really, this is a very, I mean, to think taking 10 trees down in that area, I mean, this isn't an invasive cut, not in my opinion, not on some of the jobs I'm on. This is really minor. I mean, it's, I don't think it's gonna impact the area much. It's gonna make his house safer.
What does the commission think about?
We have allowed shrubs before instead of trees.
Yeah.
We have. I think we've typically asked if it's a shrub though, that it's not a, that's not necessarily a one-to-one replacement. I can't remember.
We have our proposed tree cutting policy right here.
It doesn't have anything on shrubs.
I mean, we could stick with one-to-one, and I mean, blueberry would definitely, I think blueberry likes a wet habitat.
Yeah, high bush does certainly.
High bush.
Blueberry would be fine.
You know, and some of the shrubs, some of the shrubs can grow as, when given a chance, like those plants we saw. Can't remember the name of
Witch
them.
Hazel.
But thank you.
Red alder.
Yeah, some of these shrubs do get pretty sizable when given a chance to, you know, flourish, and they stay roughly the size of a small tree. So.
And I think we
want to.
Sorry.
No, I could see actually some shrub planting in there, adding a little diversity of habitat to that area, because it pretty much is forested right now.
With the low shrub layer, yeah.
There isn't much shrub.
Right.
Can we be clear on what trees we're gonna be able to leave more of a stump instead of a flush cut? Are there, how many do you think there are? Are there 2, 5?
Get the big pine and the good joint.
There's three close to your house, on the right and left of the house.
Left and right, right at the patio, flush. Then you get the big pine and the conjoined down low.
There's probably only
one,
maybe one or two that would stay if that would be cut high to eliminate, you know, that possibility of infestation close to his house.
2 out of 9? It's actually 10.
10.
The 10.
I'll call it 11 if you want to look at that red maple as a twin.
So let's get the 2 and then let's replace 1-to-1 with high brush blueberries, so that's 11. And let's call it a day.
And you think by using that crane, you're not going to have to cut any of those other saplings or seeds?
We spoke about that. There's one issue in the back corner of the yard, which is it's a reach, and we might have to climb. I mean, we're going to be in the trees anyway. But there's one that if I can't safely reach it with the crane, we may have to piece it down. And I told folks when we were out there that if anything does get damaged from piecing it down, we would clean up our top, cut flush, whatever gets damaged, if it does happen. We won't leave it dangling, hanging, and unsightly to the eye. Will make it safe. That's if it happens at all. It looks like I'm going to reach most of them, but I brought it up to these folks because of the just in case, and then if you come back for a revisit, well, why did this happen? I wanted to be perfectly upfront about it, just in case.
It's Jamie, it's one, it looked like it was one branch.
One good size leaf.
One
yeah.
good size branch on a tree.
And there are some smaller saplings underneath it.
Yeah, but what I think would be a shame is if around several trees all the existing vegetation was cut down to grade.
Well, we talked about this. So they're climbing the tree and they're going to lower everything down. That's you're not
yeah.
just dropping it down.
Right.
So the shrub layer was pretty sparse. I mean, there was openings in it.
But you said they were. Again, I'm at a
some
disadvantage.
Saplings.
There's some saplings in there.
There are, yeah.
And they, I would like to leave those saplings.
They should be able to get dropped in between them.
I think the order should state that, and if you find that there's an issue, come back and let Chuck know exactly which saplings you're gonna have to cut down.
I don't think we can determine that. I mean, the most important thing is that my climbers do this safely when they're up in the tree. And if roping and lowering things down in a dense area like that, and you saw the size of that leader truck that tree is growing through, it's not gonna be an easy task for the climber to get that down. So in order for us to do it safely, we could possibly damage a couple of tops up to some of the saplings, which is a small cry than to damaging a human body. And if it does get damaged, we'll top them and clean them up. I was very clear about that.
Right, top them and clean them up.
In other words, if you have a 20-foot sapling, and if we're lowering and swinging 12, 14-inch leader down, when it comes down, there is a chance that when it does come down, even if we rope it, that it could break some of the tops of these smaller saplings.
Okay.
We would cut, clean cut the areas where they break, if they break at all.
But you feel that that procedure would not prevent those saplings from continuing to grow and flourish?
In that area, I think you can see trees that get cut down to 30% of foliage left, and it will still grow in there. It's so rich in there that almost anything that gets a little bit of sunlight is gonna grow in there. So to answer your question, yes, if anything gets damaged, they will continue to grow.
I'd feel more comfortable if we stated in the determination that if any saplings are destroyed, they'll be replaced one for one.
I don't think he'll have an issue with that.
That makes sense?
Yeah.
And that gives the people in the field an extra incentive to be careful.
I just can't replace my guys one for one.
That's right.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Although there are days I'd like to.
Sure.
So one for one with a tree.
Or a comparable tree. Comparable or better.
Okay.
And one for one for the shrubs. If they destroy saplings, it would be a one for one replacement. And then for the trees that are being taken down,
mm-hmm.
it's one for
11 high bush.
Yeah, 11 high bush.
Seems
blue,
kind of
or
funny
whatever.
To replace a 90-foot white pine with a blueberry bush. But
if you saw, there's a lot of trees out there.
I'm
Again,
not worried about the health of the forested area, really. It's very dense.
This is a dense area that he's done a good job of letting the natural vegetation
good.
Grow in this whole area.
And again, the whole reason that he's going to pay a premium for this service is because of the degree of difficulty. We can't use a bucket truck. So it's going to be crane and climber, and that's it. And we're going to be lifting up, not dropping down. We're going to be hoisting stuff up into the sky and out into the street.
Just out of curiosity, those pines particularly, what do you do with the pines once you take them down?
Some of it will go right up the cannery as lumber. We have a company that comes down, we size and scale and check for nails and with a scanner, and if it's clean, we ship them up north. So we try to utilize everything that we cut down rather than waste it.
Are there any further questions or comments from members of the commission? Are there any comments from the public? Do I hear
comments from the trees?
Ouch.
Do I hear a motion? Somebody make a motion to issue a negative determination of applicability?
I'll make a motion to issue a negative determination with conditions that the 11 trees are replaced with 11 high brush blueberries, that any saplings destroyed during the taking of the trees are replaced one to one with as nice as same size trees or better. And that's it.
I'd like to make a slight amendment, friendly amendment to that. Instead of high bush blueberry, a native shrub. The client's choosing.
Which could be high bush.
Which can include high bush blueberry.
Okay. Someone second as amended?
All those in favor? Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. One other thing I did want to say, you were asking about what we do for the wood. I got involved with a school over in Stonem that helps kids that didn't make it in high school, and they have a shop over there, and I give them pine logs, and they make Adirondack chairs. So,
oh, nice.
Good cause.
Yeah, nice.
Kid called me up, he said, I understand from my sawyer who cuts the logs. He said, I understand your pine logs. I said, yes, we do. And he said, well, what do you do with them? I said, we ship them up to Canada and we get paid for them. And he goes, well, we can't really afford to pay for them. And I said, well, I says, I wish I could help you out. And right before I hung up, I said, well, what do you do with them? And he told me that he helps these kids out. It's actually a school. I says, how much do you want? So we've been taking logs to them, and I did get a couple of nice Adirondack chairs.
I was going
to
say, what do they do with the chairs?
they give them away or they sell them for charity.
What's the name of the school? Do you remember? I don't want to keep
you know, I'm not sure. It's right on Pleasant Street.
In Stonem?
In Stonem, yeah. They have a great shop. It's a great project over there. They do a real nice job.
And
I will find out for the name of you.
Do they kiln dry those pine logs? Or?
No, they stick dry them. I just dropped them off a full truckload, about 20 logs, and 2 days later the sawyer came out and he saws everything to 5-quarter thick wood, and you know, they let it stick dry, and they do. It's a really good thing, and the kids are really into it, and it's nice to see something like that these kids are getting an education and learning a trade. So
cool.
That's the best thing that came out of it.
Thank you.
Thanks very much for your time. Have a great night.
You too. The next item is
Becky.
What?
Do you want to sign this, or you want me to make the changes first?
Okay, we can sign it.
Thank you.
Yeah. How old's your son? It must be the same guy, because my son's 25. He'll be 26 next month.
My kids must know that.
Yeah, they're all about them.
Yeah, there must be a lot of them.
Next item is 3 Zachary Lane. Anika, Al, and I went out Sunday morning and explained to the property owners that they did have a small isolated wetland.
I'm sorry, I was talking to Amy and not paying attention. Could you,
well,
would
then,
you mind starting
too bad.
It was her fault, wasn't my fault.
We went out to 3 Zachary Lane on Sunday, Al, Anika, myself, and the property owners have a small isolated wetland only under the jurisdiction of the wetlands bylaw. It's a little over 500 square feet. It was identified back when that subdivision was proposed. I almost remember the delineation myself. When we met with the owners, they were concerned about some plastic trash and some sticks and some leaves that had been put there, and they were told by neighbors that they couldn't touch those wetlands or even walk in those wetlands, and they said, that's not true. You know, you can go in and remove the trash and remove leaves that have been deposited and the limb debris, and they were okay with that. They did say that people walk through their backyard. We found that a little odd because it's a beautifully manicured lawn.
On the right, the first house on the right?
Yes, right on the right. And they say that they throw trash in there.
Really?
Yeah. And there is a little bit
Does
of trash.
Does it go down? The
yes.
yard, it goes down into
yeah.
maybe.
And then there's a wooden picket fence in the back. Along the side.
On
yeah.
both sides,
I
right?
think I know
mm-hmm.
that.
Yeah.
Hmm.
And they were fine with that, and then there's a 25-foot buffer, and it looked like that it had been planted with witch hazel and red alder shrubs that have grown up beautifully, and there is wetland vegetation back in there. So
I think alder are facultative, aren't they? think they are.
Yeah, but if you're facultative, it's, you know, if you've got 50%,
Right.
Same with the witch hazel, too. So they were fine with that, and we haven't heard anything since. Have you heard anything since that?
I did follow up the phone call asking the homeowner if he would like to come to tonight's meeting. And he thought the advice he got on Sunday was sufficient for what his needs were at the moment. And he's going to contact me in the fall when they're going to do that cleanup and possibly come back to the commission next year.
Okay, that's great. Yeah, I forgot to mention that we had mentioned that they should give you a call if they want to start removing some of the debris. Because their concern was that the neighbors would call on them, seeing that they had told them that they couldn't even walk back there. So, and that's that. Are we ready to do old new business? Continue. Minor plan change, 73.
Well, Austin Prep.
Oh, Austin Prep. Yeah, well, do we know if they removed?
Austin, so we asked. We had a couple items for Austin Prep to do at the last meeting, and remove the hay bales was pretty much, you know, add some wetland seed mix, I think we asked for, written down, remove the hay bales, I guess they were spread out, and I relayed that message to Dean, what's his name? All right, so anyways, I relayed the message to them, and I haven't received any word back. Dr. Hickey, that's his name. And but I didn't get any reply, so I didn't prepare the order of conditions or the certificate of compliance. I expect when this is taken care of, they'll give me a call.
Okay.
So that was that.
73 Fairchild Drive, minor plan change.
You received in your packets a minor plan change for 73 Fairchild, and in the application it clearly states that they'll be using the existing deck and then building on top of that to put on a three-season porch. And the change has been made just to remove the entire deck and build a brand new deck in the same size, same area as the old one.
But new foundation.
We had already approved the footings because of the additional weight.
Right.
But the deck was supposed to stay.
Yeah.
So this was a minor change, to say the least, but a change nevertheless. So they put in this application for a minor plan change, and I think that you guys should approve this. Minor pictures.
This was the one that had an excellent report as well. Is that correct? I still remember that.
It's grammatically correct.
I move we approve the minor change for 73 Fairchild Drive. Minor change being replace the existing deck. I got that wrong.
Plan change, remove the existing deck and replace it with a new deck.
Right.
Aren't they adding footings to that?
Yes.
Yes.
The
but
footings
that,
were
we already approved that.
Footings are part of it already.
Because he had to put in new footings to hold up the
So these were already pre-approved.
The only thing that wasn't approved was the deck was staying and they were building on top of it.
Okay. All right. Great.
Yeah.
Go ahead. Second. It's all good.
All those in favor? Colonial Drive, Mira Giannis, minor plan change.
So, I don't know if anyone remembers all these items that Strati came in and asked us about. There were 8 items in the back of his yard, and he was qualifying for an RDA because the pool. Pool deck, retaining wall, the garage addition, and some trees that were cut. All those were 50 feet away, except for one side, which was 40 feet away. And he wanted to make a change, that he's going to do a three-season porch. He moved the, he's moving the retaining wall, and he's moving the decking area around the pool. But what's happening is, in a sense, is everything is actually getting smaller or moving closer to the house. So when he gave us this plan, he didn't have an engineer drawing do this. And what's happened is he does have that now, and he was able to kind of put the parts together. So when they started out putting the wall, instead of 4 feet ahead, it's now 4 feet closer to his house. Moved the pool back, he moved the deck back, he moved everything back. And I went out there and measured it, and the 50 feet are 54 feet, and the 40 feet is 44 feet. So this project has become smaller and further away from the wetland.
Do we have a plan?
We actually do have a plan now of his project.
No numbers.
So here we go up here. This is the 50-foot area, and this is the 40-foot side here.
Where is the old line?
The old line.
I mean the one we approved.
Is this the one where Harry was concerned about the stone wall in the back?
I believe that might be right.
Sorry.
This wasn't before.
And there was a question of the.
This is what you approved.
Existing.
Yeah,
this
yeah,
is
yeah,
the
yeah.
existing dwelling. Okay, yeah. This is looking good. I mean,
yeah.
that this is looking
yeah.
familiar.
Yeah, that is. Okay.
So this deck now, it looks like it's a building.
That's one of the changes, yeah.
And this pool is still a pool, but you're saying it's pulled back
see
toward
the angle, that. So he's cut that much off of it, so it's square now.
But this is still the footprint of the pool. That doesn't
right.
look like it.
That's 4 feet, and these are now 3 feet. Or
so it's
but
it's
but it's the same. Somehow it's the same distance, so
oh,
that's not
so the pool
change.
Changed.
But the biggest distance is the gap between here and the retaining wall. Is closer now. It's actually no gap, and that's where we've gained all that space.
Do the steps go up or down?
I think they go down. They have to go down at the house. So,
so this is I'm sorry. There's no. This is now a building, though.
Yes, instead
and
of a deck.
Three-season porch.
That wasn't proposed before.
It was just a
no.
It was something, but it didn't clear where.
It was a wooden deck before it was proposed, and now he's putting a roof on it.
Or is that an existing wooden deck?
No, it's on. It's
is that something that we think would need, like, a Coltec or a...
Yeah, I wonder what he is doing for the drainage, because that might go right into his pool.
What's his problem?
It drain off?
Al, you said that, but what do they call it now? Reading Village? What's that thing down on West Street? It used to be Archstone built it. You know, the big development.
Yeah, yeah.
Their pool overflowed and washed all that sediment down into the stream and then eventually into West Street because the drainage ran into the pool. Remember that?
Mm-hmm.
What a mess. That pool had about 3.5 feet of sand in it.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Here's the list of stuff here we approved.
But wasn't that from the road?
Maybe that's three different
ideas. Wasn't it?
No, it was from that path that came down.
Yeah, it wasn't from the roof.
No, it wasn't from
the
roof. No.
All right, so this is what we approved. An above-ground pool, 18 by 34. A decking around the pool with our concrete footings, retaining wall, 20-foot to 25-foot out from the back of the house. Stone stairs going from the retaining wall down to the level yard. Stone from the retaining wall going to the back of the house. Replace the expanded deck with concrete footings, 15 by 62. Expanding the driveway, a garage addition. It says water drainage directed to the back of the house where needed, and then one tree will be cut, and if possible, it's a 20-to-30-foot high tree. I think it's getting cut.
So, is that an order of conditions you're reading from?
No, this is an RDA. So all that stuff was approved.
In an RDA.
So, it's an RDA, yeah. Request for determination.
So this
is approved
fine with
on that plan
change
that you see right there. The commission.
So they're asking for a minor plan change.
Right.
There's
I have no issue with that.
And what do you have?
Make a motion to approve the minor change at 112 Colonial Drive.
Second.
All those in favor?
Is Amy abstaining?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And there's a certificate of compliance for 1261 Main Street. We took an inspection on Sunday morning. Anika, did you guys go out?
You,
yeah.
Me, and Al drove.
Madam Chairman, can we see what these people are here for and take care of the issue first?
It's Low Arcadia.
Arcadia.
Could we take care of that first so they can go home?
Certainly.
Unless you want to sit and listen to us.
So we issued an ORAD, an order of resource determination, resource area determination. Not the last meeting, but the previous meeting. I know Chuck has been in contact, or you guys have been in contact with each other. And the last meeting you had a lot of questions, and we had left it that we would try to get a hold of the applicant to see if they would provide additional information vis-a-vis soil borings. They declined. Mr. Tarone did contact Steve Erickson, and they declined. He declined on behalf of the applicant.
To take more soil borings,
yes,
or provide the locations of those he already had?
He said that they didn't do them with a GPS, and he would do that, but he would prefer to do it when they do the notice of intent. And so he declined to do that too. He said, I'm not going to do that for this. He said, we really don't want to do anything else, because he didn't want to spend any of his client's money. We were kind of left with an answer, you know, not a great answer, but, you know, he had been out there a couple of times, once with me and the chair, and then I think once with the commission.
Right. So within 21 days of not the last meeting, but the previous meeting, we had to sign that ORAD, and we did that the day. With the 21 days came up right after last meeting. We signed the ORAD. We had 4 or 5 signatures, and we know.
So that was approximately 2 weeks ago.
It was on the 30th.
June 31st.
It was last day.
Last week.
So Chuck called you so that if you wanted, you had a certain amount of time to file an appeal with Massachusetts Department of Environmental Protection. So he wanted to make sure you knew that started that clock, and that's why he called you.
Right. What is that appeal, Chuck? Is it 10 days or 21 days?
It's
It's a 10-day appeal.
10 days? And that's 10 business days, right?
Usually 10 days, yeah, 10 business days.
10 business days. Yeah.
I'll count Saturdays and Sundays.
Worth adding, one of the dangers of letting that 21, not that we ever want to let the 21-day lapse, but one of the dangers of letting that 21-day lapse is, Truck did a lot of work to get that riverfront, figure out that that is actually riverfront. I think it was always apparent to us, but it's not on the
USGS as a blue line.
And so if that went to the state, there's a possibility that they would just look at that data.
Yeah, they don't
say,
know the area, yeah.
Exactly, and say, well, no, it doesn't. It's not showing up as a river, therefore it's not a river. And
right, well, as strict constructionist as DEP can be, it says in the regulations that to determine perennial or intermittent, you look to the USGS maps, and a blue line will indicate that it's perennial. So if they fell back on that, you know, we would have lost all that work. I just think that was an important part of this determination.
Yeah, absolutely.
Mr. Magusa.
Yeah, Magusa. Good memory. So, I want to thank Chuck for actually reaching out and spending as much time as he did on the phone with me, and he was very, very good and gave us all the details we needed. My only question that I didn't get to ask you, Chuck, but when Anika brought up last meeting, back to what you were saying, we didn't want to lose all that work, right? Anika had mentioned that very thing at the last meeting, and we looked at the notes, and at that time, there was no determination. You guys didn't approve the ORAD, right? That's what we were told. So that was the last meeting that we were here 2 weeks ago. We looked at the notes, and we can go back to the notes to reread them. I just want to know what happened in between, because you guys went off, and I'm just saying this because we have a lot of upset neighbors. It looks like you guys pulled a fast one. And that's what the neighborhood is basically saying. And I've said this a number of times, one of the reasons why I'm here, it's just not for my own personal reasons, but also to make sure that we're supporting you guys as a committee, right?
You're saying the notes.
So can we go back to 2 weeks ago, Anika? You remember when you brought that up and you said legally, you used the word legally, we have X number of days to make a determination?
I cannot go back 2 weeks.
That's okay.
Very honestly, because so much is covered in each meeting and so many discussions are had, and these meetings are every 2 weeks. You know, so that puts me a month back and a million discussions ago. So I could go back to the RCTV and look into what you're saying, but I did go back to the May 11, and during that May 11 meeting, I looked it up and emailed conservation when it came up that in a certain part of the RCTV, thank you RCTV, recording, there was a motion made to issue an ORAD, and that was done at the May 11th meeting.
A motion approved?
No approval. That's what was missing in the notes, and that's the part that people are hearing.
A motion to issue an ORAD.
But did we approve that motion?
I believe we did.
You did.
I believe
you did.
There was a second.
We did. There was
a
second,
second,
and we voted it that night.
So we did vote.
We did vote it
and
on the 11th.
You're
I'm
saying
sure.
That was not in the meeting minutes?
Jamie, can...
It is in... Go ahead.
There's a confusion here, and I actually have the same confusion of, you know, we made a vote to issue, and we did have this conversation last meeting.
Yes.
We made a vote to issue. Is that closing the meeting? Or is that approving it? And we had the discussion last meeting, and we seemed to make the determination that it wasn't closing the meeting.
Well,
and then after the fact,
okay,
we watched the video, and we decided that it was closing the meeting.
I'm not sure a meeting,
a hearing.
An official
hearing
is required for an ORAD.
Well, that's.
I think it's only for notice of intent, but we ought to check that.
That's where the confusion is. Right.
And even if, so if you made a motion to issue and you seconded it, you could issue it. But if you don't close it, and it's hard to get your head around this, if you don't close it, that lets you discuss it further. That's why, tell me if I'm wrong, but when we have an order of conditions and we've made a motion to issue, but you can still, if you don't close it, you could still discuss it, right, legally.
Well, it doesn't say in the Wetlands Protection Act that you have 21 days to close it. It does say you have 21 days to issue it. So once you utter the words issue, the clock starts on the 21 days.
I think that's the confusion that occurred in this commission last meeting.
Yeah, and if I may, what happened was we looked at the notes and we looked for the word approved, to your point, that added even more confusion, and there was no approval, plus there was no closing of the meeting, which basically left it open for further discussion. So
right.
My point is, I'm not trying to hold you guys accountable to, this is not, that's not my thing. The point I'm trying to make is, when I went back and I talked to the neighborhood, based on the conversation we had, I felt like I was a board member. I was being questioned and harassed, and basically they were saying, "How this is not possible. Did you make the agreement? They heard one thing. They heard one thing here, right? And it's been recorded. And now what happened was, and Chuck, did I give you a hard time that day when we were calling? And you basically, I was blindsided.
Yeah, a little bit. I had my hand on the phone. The police.
911.
Yeah.
But the point I'm making is.
You dialed it back a bit, and so I let it continue.
It couldn't have been that bad, because we were on the phone for quite a bit. But so I was taking, and Chuck basically said, "You ready for this?
Well,
and
I think
here's the deal." So I was taken back, but then I understood, okay, I had questions in my head about what transpired the last conversation. To your point, we looked into this, it was confusing, and there were a lot of people here, a lot of people heard this, and now it's looking like the committee did something backdoor.
Right.
I'm just giving you a heads up.
So let me try to, when you were talking, what I heard you say again was that everyone is looking for that word approval, but we don't use that. We use issue. Issue starts the clock. When you write, we're not approving the fact that we're issuing something. So step one, we issue. 21 days starts, and that happened 2 weeks prior to the last meeting, okay? That starts the clock, the word issue. So we're not gonna hear approval when that happens, because what we do is we approve the order of conditions, or the ORAD. They submit an ORAD, we give them an ANRAD. That's an approval of the resource area, all right? So we're approving it. So we're gonna issue it, then we're gonna approve it, and the commission needed to do this in between meetings because we were asked to get some additional information, or at least ask the question to the applicant whether he would provide that additional information. But he knew we only had 21 days.
Let's throw the word approval out.
Okay.
We still, on the notes, I'm just going back to the notes that were read to the public. We didn't, and somebody here asked, Rebecca, I think you asked, did we close this meeting? And the meeting, we didn't document that this meeting was closed.
I saw the video, and we did ask the question.
I'm not making
right.
It.
Right, so the word close means we stop all discussion.
Right.
We do not take any more information from the applicant or the abutters. But you asked some questions.
Yep.
So
we
it was
can't
all still
close
open.
It.
Yeah. So, hear me out for 1-2 seconds.
Okay.
Great. Awesome. We kept on. We continued because we didn't close it. We continued. We made some requests, and a decision was made to send a certified letter saying, "Here, it's approved." So what you're saying is, because of the timing, we didn't have an opportunity to meet again today to basically, in public, say we've approved this. The requests were not, he's not going to fulfill the requests, but we're approving it anyway. That didn't happen at the 2 week, you know how we have these meetings here. It didn't happen at that meeting, this meeting today. It happened in between. And that's the confusion here, and that's what's being, the perception is, you guys went off and did something without public hearing.
If I could just ask a question. My memory is that we did have a motion and a second, and then voted to issue that ANRAD. And that vote, should be recorded in the minutes, and I think it was.
It is in the minutes.
It was, and it is. And then last week, we had a discussion of, was the meeting closed?
Right.
And we said, no, it was not closed.
It wasn't closed. So then we had further discussion.
We had further discussion, but we also had the understanding that that meant that we still had the 21 days.
Yeah.
And it did.
That's
again, there's a difference legally between a meeting and a hearing. The hearing, we have to open and read, and it has all those conditions, and then that hearing has to be closed. Now, I don't think that this was a hearing for an ORAD. I think it was on the agenda and discussed the application, but
Jamie,
I could be wrong.
Jamie, if I may, that was discussed 2 weeks ago.
Right.
And we determined that it wasn't a hearing.
Was not a hearing. Okay.
Yeah. We looked at the notes. We had, I'm not sure.
We should check the regulations for future.
I just want to bring this up because that's the perception, that's the buzz, okay? I've had the opportunity to talk to Chuck.
That's the problem with continuing the discussion in that 21-day period.
Yes.
Probably what we should have done is said, we already voted on that and we can't have any further discussion, but we were trying to, you know, help you guys out and ask him for some additional information.
No, I agree with you
100%. Keep giving you guys information, but by law, we're held by that 21 days.
I agree with you 100%.
Somebody on the board at the last meeting should have said, listen, we can ask this guy, but we only have 21 days. We're gonna have to sign this before the next meeting, but none of us thought of that.
Yeah.
No, the thing is, I agree with you 100%. The board didn't know because we had to go and double check, right? And that's the, at the end of the day, I'm not trying to catch you guys on a technicality here. I'm just telling you that the perception.
Well, we can't help perception.
But Al, that doesn't make things easy going forward, right?
Well, can I just add,
easy for who?
Well, let me just add, you know, town volunteers are held to ethical standards that are determined by the State Ethics Commission. And we go through ethics training, and it's made very clear to us from the town manager, board of selectmen, throughout everybody we interact with in the town, that ethics are, and following the rules of, you know, Robert's Rules of Order and town bylaws is, you know, you follow that or, you know, you're not going to be on a board for very long.
Not just that. We have no reason to short sheet anybody.
I'm not here to say that.
We wouldn't do that. To say that the perception is that we did something underhanded is to say that collectively as a board, we got together and said, hey, you know, these neighbors, we're going to just listen to them and do whatever we want.
I don't think you guys are saying that.
That's crazy.
We're not, Al, I'm just basically telling you, perception is reality, right? And we heard something different. We walk away. I had the opportunity to talk to Chuck. Okay, I'm not sitting here saying I'm upset with what happened. I'm basically telling you when I went back and communicated, because one of the things Chuck said, go back and get together. But that's, yeah, I'm just giving you a heads up. Al,
no, I know, but we can't. But we can't help that. That's all I'm
think
saying.
I would say this. I think that from my perspective, I think the communication
could have been better. Well,
could have been
that.
Better.
Absolutely.
And
the direction could have been a lot better.
We still made the appropriate decisions to sign when we were supposed to sign. The communication, particularly from the last meeting, I think could have been better.
I think
and
this,
we need to keep
I
that
think
in
this
mind,
happened.
And we need to make sure that we understand that.
I think this happened out of an abundance of caution for the abutters trying to do as much as we could to satisfy you guys.
Yes, and I don't disagree.
I agree with you.
Yeah.
Dave Rauchy, 117 Arcadia. And on, you know, my neighbor's defense, too, is that you do hear, and rightly so, we have told everyone that, you know what, you guys have been very, very fair and very knowledgeable, and we came in here not knowing, you know, really anything, and you educated us, so, you know, we applauded you, and, you know, we thank you for your service, and, you know, it's not an easy job, you know, you're hearing us last week, and we were very defensive, you know, trying to ask the right questions and so forth, and, you know, you did, Al, you went beyond probably what you probably should have,
well,
we appreciated it, and as taxpayers, and as abutters, and, you know, caring people, I mean.
A lot of board members put a lot, Harry, who's not here tonight,
correct.
Chuck,
and
Anika put a lot of hours into those flags.
I've seen you guys out there
Chuck was out there in his waders, he walked the whole stream in the pouring rain.
I agree with you, and that's why I said, you know, just like we've been saying right from the get-go, we just want a fair share.
Well, listen, you guys get another bite at the apple, this is just the first step, if this ANRAD's approved, if the applicant's going to do something, you'll all be notified. This whole thing will happen again. We'll have another public hearing. We'll review all the information and digest that, and we'll make another decision. But, you know, if this applicant comes in and applies for something that's within the rules, he's going to get approved. So, I mean, we're not here. We can't just not approve something because the abutters don't like it. If it's a complete application, and inspect it, and we go through everything that we go through in every application and determine that it's within the rules.
I wouldn't approve anything without seeing it.
Oh, no, I'm not saying that. I'm just saying if it's...
I get it. No, we appreciate it.
You know, if it does come to a notice of intent, and that would be the next step.
That's the next step, a notice of intent. This is just step one. The next step is probably a more important step.
Our uncertainty and not knowing how the steps in the process and how everything goes, and rightly so. I mean, I was blindsided by that with the confusion, like I mentioned in the last meeting and so forth, and, you know, you guys were nice enough to clarify a lot of it. But on that confusion, on that night, there was that confusion. And
you know, we want, you know, Chuck, you know, thank Chuck for, you know, reaching out to you guys when we found out that we needed to make this signature so that you guys could hear right away. You know, I think
he did what he was supposed to do, and I thanked them then. I thanked them again, and all I'm saying is that there was some confusion when I went back and reported per Chuck, hey, go talk to Dave and the other neighbors, let them know what's going on. I did, just leave it at that. It wasn't a good conversation.
It's very confusing. What might be there might not be there. How you determine, you know, your causes and so forth. And like I said, you know, I mean, I, you know, Mr. Magazu and everyone along that strip has dealt with the committees before.
Did you guys hire anyone to?
Yeah, we're looking into it. Thank you.
Are you getting close to that? Because I think that would be great when you get your wetland scientist out there to review that line, and you know, when you put down your 10 grand or 20 grand, you find out it doesn't move at all.
Chuck, there's a couple of options, right?
That's gonna be.
Yeah.
The cold reality.
And
I mean, it may move, but...
might move an inch. Right.
What I'm trying to say is that there's so much knowledge on this commission, and we do kind of speak that conservation language. And I think every time you guys left, you thought that it was automatic that you would return for another meeting. So we only do things in meetings. That's what you thought.
Mm-hmm.
But we did issue the order, which was missed by everybody. And I think they had so much time to think that they were coming to a next meeting. The following meeting they did, it wasn't mentioned again, or it seemed confusing that everyone had enough time to really buy into that thought,
right,
that only things happen in meetings. And I think it's confusing, and I understand where you guys are at, but this commission has to be fair, and Al was right that we just have to look at things fairly, and we took a lot of time to help you guys, but there was a few things that was missed. And I think when we issue another thing with an RDA or a request for determination of applicability, we say that we're gonna issue you guys a negative determination. And that on its face sounds like it's the wrong determination. You don't want that because that's, it's negative, the word is negative. But really what it means is you're approved. It's kind of counterintuitive, but that's how this works. These, you know, when we're using these terms that came from the Wetlands Protection Act, that came from the regulations, it's kind of, you know, written that way so everyone knows what you're talking about, but you gotta buy into the language first. And again, I apologize that we didn't pick up on the confusion, mm-hmm. but we still had to kind of follow the process. And when that 21 days came up, we really needed to sign that. And I guess maybe the only other thing that we could do here is, like, you know, say that when the rest of the neighbors come in, we'll try to explain it again. But I'm sure that with this and with maybe the upcoming notice of intent, which hasn't been filed, I haven't heard anything, but, you know, obviously that might be step two if it happens, that you guys will be a little bit further down the track. And like
you
it,
also
and
should note that this NRAD is good for 3 years. They might not file for 3 years.
Right.
They have up to 3 years.
And
this
something
what we
had
approved.
To be,
excuse me.
Some
I
line
ask
had
question?
To be determined. There's no option not to determine
Chuck,
a line.
Chuck,
wait.
So
yeah,
what,
okay.
What was the date of the issuance of the
31st.
No,
it was before that.
No, it's the 2 weeks prior.
May 11th.
Oh, what was the day that we...
May 11th? Yeah,
it's, I wasn't,
the
11th. It was the May 11th. I wasn't here.
Yeah.
21
so
days.
The,
May 11th.
The appeal period has expired.
The appeal...
Well, 30
us,
days. I don't know. I need a calendar. So
it,
from,
for
it was
us
issued
to,
on the 31st.
It would be July. It would be June 10th.
It's June. It's
September. Not when the meeting's voted
on.
It's issued. So we didn't sign it until.
Okay,
we
so you signed it on the
30th. We signed it
right.
on the
31st. So with this.
So,
so that means the appeal period is up
soon,
either Friday or Monday.
Friday.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Correct?
Correct. 10 days.
10 business days.
Yeah.
Or 10 whatever.
No. So. Thank you. No, I mean, they just. Well, we don't even know if you guys are going to approve it tonight. You already voted, but...
No, hold on. See, there's still confusion.
No.
It's been...
There's no vote.
No,
there's
no
vote.
Vote.
No vote.
It's done.
It's done.
The 31st, that's the confusion. See?
It's on the agenda tonight to hear your input.
Oh, okay. Thank you. Not much input.
Chuck doesn't want to hear me.
No, no, I...
And you know what, Chuck?
It's
why
not that
do
we don't
want to
hear it.
Why
it's,
do we
you know,
keep putting it on
we
the agenda?
We want to get it out of here as quick as we can. It's not that we
are
don't
we,
care. We do.
Yeah.
Well, I'll tell you why I put this on the agenda, because I put it on the agenda and I said that was issued. So I wanted everyone who... There's a lot of people that look at the agenda. So to just have it disappear, kind of like what you guys were saying,
yeah,
it's another reason. I mean, at least I wanted to have that closure.
As above board as you can.
Yeah,
hopefully the abutters are watching.
It won't be
tonight,
on the next agenda.
And I'm sure that they are. Some will be.
So, but we did need to at least, you know, retrace our
you
steps.
You guys will all be re-notified. You'll get another
right.
certified letter when they apply, if and when they do, is
right.
what I should say.
Okay.
And we'll just go back and recommunicate what happened.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's all we can do.
Do you have any comments, any questions?
I just think it's very confusing that I don't understand all the language either, so. There we go. Yeah. So that's why I've come to try to understand it.
Yes. Okay.
You guys will go.
Thank you.
Thank
guys.
You.
It's a river
yeah.
that's
for coming
stream,
in.
Stream, right?
Hmm?
Or is that for sure?
Well,
it was
for the next 3 years,
it's a river.
It's a river.
It's a river.
And then
no,
they.
I think that it is always a
river.
Yeah.
In all likelihood.
Yes.
He's right. He's absolutely right. That has never been determined not to be a river.
Correct.
But for that property, he has an ORAD. He can't try to change that decision for 3 years.
Once it passes the appeal period, that line is in existence legally and can't be changed for 3 years.
3 years.
Yeah.
The only quick question I have, and the committee is volunteered, obviously, and some of you guys might be out of here in a 3-year process. How does that work for?
I'm sorry, I missed that.
I'm sorry. You guys are all volunteer members, and if you leave in the next, say, 3 years, and you know, we have 3 years to say it comes up in 3 years from now. How does the, you know, say you step down or whoever steps down?
You want to be on the here? You can have my seat right now.
No. I want your space. No, it's not the question. The question is like, so how does all this, you know, come
we
by? Because you guys voted on a certain. And does the committee that comes in have to go by your rulings, or do they change the rules?
If it's within 3 years.
All over again.
If it's within 3 years, that line is still good.
Stays good.
Stays.
He's saying how many changes there are.
He's saying after the 3 years, the line becomes.
After the 3 years, if they decide to do anything, they would have to either file another ANRAD or a notice of intent. And it would have to have a delineation, and we would have to look at what had been filed before,
right.
Whoever was on the board. Lots of times, you know, things happen, and there's like 5 years go by, and we'll ask Chuck, what happened? You know, what was filed?
You have to notice one thing, and that's great, and I'm just going to add to it, and Jamie could probably say this better, but every time it's determined to be a river,
mm-hmm.
it's harder to unwind that.
Oh, good, okay.
Yeah. That's a river
so
for...
That's
state.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Gotcha.
All right. Jeez, I thought you wanted an application.
Been there for a long time, and, you know, I'm sure...
No, I checked every permit going down Arcadia.
Yeah.
And then every permit going down the road on the other side. Not one was intermittent stream. They were all called riverfront.
In the regulations, there is an empirical definition of a river. If the drainage area exceeds a certain number of acres, it is a river. And that is measured, and that does not change except over geological time.
Gotcha. And again, thank you for your service.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Appreciate it. Have a good weekend.
Yeah.
You too.
All right, where were we? How many acres? 400?
It's 1 acre, or it's a half acre with certain soils.
Square mile, not acre.
Square mile, yeah, square mile.
Did we?
1 acre. Everything is green. Everything is river.
12 feet. Yep.
An
order.
Certificate
of compliance for
1261
Main Street.
So wait a second. So, what am I? We all getting the right thing here? When we vote on something, we should close the hearing.
No.
So that these discussions can't go on after it's already voted on? Isn't that what we should do procedurally?
I think it should be clear just to make sure everyone understands what it means, just like when you're saying a negative determination. Maybe now that we realize it's confusing.
Well, that's fine. We can explain to an applicant or the audience. But for us, when we
we
should close.
Okay, then correct me if I'm wrong. If we go to, and we haven't got the order of conditions written, we have to review it. And then... we can't discuss it, and the people can't discuss it. So you would want to keep it
open. In this case, we had the INRAD, Chuck had the INRAD prepared on the 11th. It was voted on, it was prepared, it could have been signed, and it could have been closed.
Why didn't we sign
on the 11th?
Because of those questions that
they
were asking.
Because of these questions. We can't
I actually
allow
held it
that after
and
we
said
vote
I
on
I
it.
I have it, yeah.
Yeah, we can't allow that after we vote.
11th, or not the 11th.
No,
the last meeting.
Was it the 20-something?
The problem was we made a vote to issue, and we had this conversation. The last meeting was, did we close it? And we were under the interpretation that if we didn't close it, that was when we had the 21 days. And we came after the fact that said no, that's when we issue.
This is all spelled out in the regulation. It really is not a debatable issue.
You read it and report back to us.
What I'm suggesting is that we ask DEP for clarification.
Yes.
On an INRAD.
Well, we should definitely on an INRAD.
No,
we should probably do it on an order of conditions and an NOI also, just so we know.
Yes, absolutely.
I mean, Chuck, if you can, you could go through the regulations and develop that, but it might be better to have DEP either tell us or confirm what you come up with, just so we're on firm footing.
Okay.
I've been to...
Because I thought my understanding was if it's an RDA, it's not, you know, it's not a hearing.
Correct.
That's correct.
And
it's
so
a
you
meeting.
Don't close it.
Right, you can't close
it. And if it's a notice of
this.
Intent, you read the script, it's officially opened as is declared in the script when you're opening the notice of intent, and then after the order of conditions is issued, then you close it.
Before we went to a part-time administrator,
oh
before Chuck came, it was a very clear process. And what we did was we had all the meetings we wanted to have. We reached concurrence on the issues within the order of condition. Then the administrator drafted the condition. Then at the next meeting, we went over it, discussed it with the applicant here, reached consensus on the wording and the order of conditions, and then we voted to issue it as modified at that meeting and close the hearing at the same time, and it was crystal clear. There was no question, no gray area.
So you both always closed on the same hearing?
Pardon me?
Issued and closed on the same
Absolutely.
Hearing?
Absolutely, on the same night,
yeah.
Same time. And
that
then there it was.
Sense.
That just eliminates all of this.
That eliminates this discussion. Where we got into a bind was we had a part-time administrator. We couldn't get the order of conditions drafted in time for the hearing. So we said, okay, well, we've agreed what we're going to do. Let's issue it, and then it would come back to us in 2 weeks. And sometimes we close the hearing, sometimes
you
we wouldn't.
You could really go back to that.
I think that should be our policy. But in order to do that,
I agree
we're going to have the order of conditions at the meeting and in advance of the meeting so we could have read it. And, you know, an hour or two before the meeting.
We wouldn't vote at that meeting. We would,
no.
We would get in our time for comment, public comment, the applicant's presentation, and then the vote would occur the next
following meeting.
So you continue it to the next meeting.
Vote it and close it.
And then there would be a vote to continue, I guess.
Because I always remember, you vote to issue and then you vote to close it. I remember doing that.
They should be done at the same time in an ideal world, but we got in this bind where we couldn't get the order of conditions drafted.
Well, we're not in that bind anymore.
Quickly.
So,
Chuck.
So the order of conditions was sent out to the commission and they were able to.
In the package.
In
the package,
packet.
We had a hard copy. We were not as electronically advanced. So we had a hard copy and everybody read it. Or was supposed to read it, and then we'd go over it page by page. Any issues?
So you guys would make your own notes and then bring all that back to the commission. So Fran Fink would take handwritten notes on that,
and we'd order it to issue this order of conditions as modified in the meeting.
Would you ever check out the redrafted order of conditions prior to it being sent out, based on what you've handwriting stuff?
Generally not.
Probably not.
Generally not. If we had whole sections that were modified, we
continue
the hearing and send out those modified. But that was not.
How do you see this happening in the electronic age, where if I sent all the orders of conditions out to the commission, because there's no sense printing them, and then you guys, you can either modify them on your home computers and bring that to the commission, and then we could talk about them again. Does that work? But
okay.
It doesn't come back to me in between meetings.
That would work, but we would have to have those by Friday prior to the meeting.
Right. But I also
getting them on Wednesday night isn't going to work.
Or Tuesday.
But what I'm seeing,
or
you say, and then some of them are more difficult than others, and some of them you can really just
put
out there.
We don't modify them largely.
There's a lot of cookie cutter ones that are pretty easy.
Yeah, that's
but when you
saying.
Have like an artist or Johnson's Woods or something like that, those are tough.
A big project.
But what I'm hearing Jamie say is we're not closing or issuing. So if something happened, I could say, you know, guys, I didn't get to it. You know, my fault or whatever. There's really no pressure still, and it could be put on to the next meeting. Or if you look at the half I did, and then go on from there.
I mean, I guess that would be my take is, even if it was Wednesday night, or even if somebody came with notes, I mean, that's basically what was happening before, that's when it would get addressed, and I mean, we could still at that point go for it. At least
right.
Now we just have it in our hands, and then we
I do remember we used to sit here and go through the order of conditions for some of the big things, and it took a little bit of time.
Page by page.
And there's certainly.
We don't have to go back to quite that extreme, but that general process is good.
No.
I think waiting till we have it in hand and then going to that meeting and.
Most of it that's gonna be modified is gonna be discussed at the previous meeting, right? So we're gonna discuss it. And Chuck's gonna create it, and that he's gonna create what we discussed at the previous meeting. So there, unless it's like we're saying a huge project.
And then we're gonna review it previous to the meeting, so that we can just, if we have changes.
If there's some minor changes, which sometimes there are, Chuck handwrites them and it's over.
So we get a copy and the applicant gets a copy prior to the meeting. They can come in.
All electronic though. You're talking electronic, you say copy, yeah, okay.
Yeah.
I think that's, yeah, electronic is fine.
I think we should try it.
I think
not even try it. I think that I can't see why it wouldn't work.
Right.
No try, just do.
Okay.
I can't see why it wouldn't work.
Certificate of compliance with 1261 Main Street, Ahern.
What's 1261?
That's the one near
the. The little one on Main Street.
Right off the.
Can't get in and out of.
Highway.
North or south?
It's no up. It's near
this is the adult bookstore, right?
yeah, it is.
What? I don't know.
He's got
the
adult bookstore in his head. He says that every meeting.
Adult bookstore many times.
I haven't heard. I don't remember it, I guess.
That was you.
All right.
He said it for the Anika last five
notes.
Meetings.
I know.
The grass appeared to be fairly well established.
It was sod.
We did see a nice brush pile back there. We thought that should be taken out.
In a tire.
Yep, there's a tire there.
And some fencing.
Yeah, chain link fence in there too.
Yeah. The three new trees are planted, which is what they had proposed to do in the arborvitae.
And that concrete bound appeared to be not exactly. Wasn't it closer to the house as opposed to the 25-foot?
Yep, there are two bounds that are closer, that are between 25 and 35 feet. But it's the two end bounds. So I didn't see a big issue with that. The silt fencing, the black fencing was still there and needs to be taken up. What else?
There appeared to be a little bit of difference.
It's called a for sale sign.
It's sold, yeah.
There's somebody there. There seemed to be a couple inches between the height of the lawn, established lawn, and then the, you know, pine duff adjacent to it.
Yep, and the only other, there's two other things that make it different from the proposed plan. The deck stairs go down to the wetland side, and on the proposed plan they go away from the wetland side, so that's something they did differently.
That footing's actually in the 35.
Yeah, in the corner of the pad, concrete pad at the base in the 35. Also the.
It's in the 35?
Yep.
Just
According to this drawing, the corner nips it.
And the retaining wall near between the driveway and the wetland on the proposed plan was two separate walls. More of a terraced type of yard, and that wall is about 6 feet high. Did you ever get any engineering specs for the wall? I mean, I don't know if you looked at it too closely, Al.
Well, I mean, once you get over, I think it's 3 feet, Mike.
Three or four.
Five.
Four.
I'm talking about for the headers, the structural matting in the back.
Yeah.
I think it's 3 or 4 feet. It's supposed to be compacted in a couple rows of 4 foot headers, and that's a 6 foot wall. So, I mean, that's a structural thing. I'm not sure. I mean, the home wall, I guess that could possibly, if it wasn't installed correctly, breach and go into the wetlands. We should make
But that has to be inspected and signed off on by the building department.
Well, so I think at 5 feet is when I
could be wrong.
You
think
that.
It's five?
Well,
I thought it was four, but this one's six, so
this
it's definitely
so
above
it. Past both of them. So,
right.
I mean, yes, I think that's when it's supposed to.
Supposed to have structural engineering stamp the drawing?
Exactly, yes.
Well, civil engineers stamp the
drawing.
And
that's the reason why you terrace it, is to try and
avoid,
avoid that.
Cut it down so you don't have to.
Well, it's also safer, it's not just to avoid the stamping, a terraced situation.
Doesn't mean that.
I think if they terraced it here, they wouldn't get a car in there, that was the issue. That would've came farther back into the driveway.
There's also something, Mr. Couillard noticed, and that was the Jersey barrier just downhill of the, and to the left of the driveway was, sort of excavated out, and the soils from that were put even closer to the wetland at the top of slope.
The Jersey barrier?
I'll show you on the plan here, Al.
Was the Jersey barrier excavated out, was it pulled and they kind of spread?
The existing Jersey barrier along that side of the road, and there's no sidewalk.
Is that the town's Jersey barrier?
It was like a square excavated out, like 3 feet by 6 feet, and it looked like they dug it out and tossed it all on a pile here.
Is getting buried.
And the slope is pretty steep.
Yeah, very steep.
Sand from the winter, and it just, it is half buried anyway. But I, on the inside of it, it was excavated out.
It's on town land or state highway.
And the soil was put here.
State highway, right?
So.
Yeah, they would do it.
I mean, doesn't mean the homeowner didn't do it, but it's on the state right away.
So we're not gonna issue, no.
So we're not ready to issue it then?
Cause I think it sounds like there's still some things to be done.
Yeah, remove the trash and remove the salt fence.
And what about that pile of soil on the road?
That's what the soil.
As I said, remove the trash.
Certificates of compliance.
I think we have.
For similar things, so.
So the soil has to be removed, the brush pile in the back.
Where's the
and
soil?
The silt fence. It's here. It's at the top of a steep slope there.
So where do they move it to?
You don't think it needs to be? I mean, is it on their property?
Yeah.
I don't think it is.
I don't think it is.
That is, the Al's drawing's not on their property, that's on state right away.
Oh, that's the, okay.
Yeah, the thick line is the.
I mean.
Yeah, it's questionable whether or not it's on the property. Maybe the bottom half of it on the hill, or the bottom a little bit, maybe, but. Actually, if you look, what is that?
How much excavation, I mean, if that's, I guess I don't know who did that and whether this is gonna continue.
So that's definitely, if you look at the topography, Anika, that's definitely above their lot line, cause it's on the tallest slope.
Yeah, no, I see it on the plan.
So that's Mass Highway Department right away. Right?
Yeah, but the property owner could have done that, even though it's not their property.
I just don't know if it's a sign of more to come, of like excavating over there, but.
I didn't see it, so I don't know what.
I would do it.
Quite what would.
Well, it was done. That driveway is tight.
There's people dumping.
I think, yeah.
On town property, so people will do.
All sorts of things.
I think it's fair to ask them to remove the silt fence and the brush pile back there. I'm uncomfortable with this one. I just.
And the debris.
It might be worth a question to see if they.
The same thing as the.
What?
The brush pile?
Yeah.
There's debris back there. It's all in the same pile.
Correct. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, there's a tire. Yep.
It might be worth a question just asking them if they know about it, if they did it. Because.
They're
going to
say no.
Okay.
I don't think we should be asking, even if they did, I don't think we should be asking them to do anything on something that's not their property. Right.
Well, honestly, standing in that driveway, they're going to feel like it's their property. Because they have to,
but
it's their driveway.
But we know from the line that it's not their property.
And the tree is practically on Mass Highway property. You know, it's.
What was the purpose of doing this? Could you tell?
I couldn't decipher why somebody would do that. I don't know. I couldn't figure it out.
I think it was a telephone pole or something.
No,
it's a square.
It was
excavated in a square.
I didn't go and see it. I was hearing excavation
maybe
on the side of a hill.
Maybe 3 feet by 4 feet, maybe 6 or 8 inches deep. And all right,
so this is being continued.
Who
did
that and why?
We're going to go through this all again at the next meeting when the guy actually shows up for his certificate of compliance. So
maybe we can ask what happened.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. Fine. Oh. What's on the next agenda? Release bond?
So what?
I thought we were gonna keep that.
Let's talk about a donation on this next one.
I should recuse myself.
So, let's see. Mariano Drive, 92, oh, sorry, it's Mariano Drive, it's Sanborn Lane. Sanborn Lane, Mariano Drive.
Lot two?
Lot two.
And?
I have everything I need to, and issued the certificate of compliance at the last meeting. As a matter of fact, lot two and, so, 270-0626 and 270-0627. One is the driveway and the roadway, and one is the lot two. I have received all the information I need. We issued the certificate of compliance for both of these. Al recorded it and provided me the proof of recording. And now we're down to the last step, which is just the commission has to make a simple motion to release the bond on these two, and we can process that tomorrow.
That doesn't release the one that hasn't been approved,
no.
Yeah.
No.
I move we
three separate ones.
Release the bond, the two bonds, one for 92 Sanborn Lane, lot two, and one for 92 Sanborn Lane. So that's bond for 270-0626 and 270-0627.
Do I hear a second?
I'll second.
Those in favor?
So, one question. What is the time frame on lot three?
No, I'm.
It's not up to you. It sounds like it's not up to you.
It is. I'm waiting for the landscaper to go landscape lot one, and he's busy, and I'm trying to finish two other projects.
All right. So at least it's getting worked on.
All right. It's on the list.
So, I don't know if you've seen it. I mean, it's nicer weather now. Has grass. Gotten a little better.
I haven't been to Mariano in about a week and a half, so I would think so. I mean, the guy's got to think. I sent my guys over last week. They had an issue with his irrigation that was straightened out probably 2 weeks ago now. So I'm assuming that he's watering and fertilizing. The guy's been putting pots around, so I'm assuming it looks better. But I should have drove through today before today.
Okay.
Thank you.
You're
welcome. Friends and Family Day, Saturday, 11 to 3. Who's going from 11?
Okay, let me read the list from last week, or from 2 weeks ago.
We wrote it down so we can.
Yeah, so everybody is locked in. 11 to 1, Mike and Anika. 1 to 2, Jamie. 2 to 3, Al. And then I have 2 to 3, Mike again. Is that true?
No.
And then 1 to 3, Becky. And then I have you again, Mike.
Oh.
4 to 5.
Just doing the pickup.
Yeah.
It's over.
Did you offer?
Four,
did you offer
three.
Me to pick
no.
up everybody else's?
It's 11
too, right?
He's gonna help with the ground crew.
Oh, I appreciate that.
Man,
you know, it's a good thing I opened up my calendar.
So could you read it again, please?
Sure.
Go ahead and try.
11 to 1. 11 to 1, Mike. And 11 to 1 also, Anika. Jamie is 1 to 2. And then 2 to 3, Al. And then 2 to 3, Mike again. And then 1 to 3 would be Becky. And then 4 to 5, Mike with the ground crew.
So, Mike, you're there all day.
I guess so.
These kids,
so,
Jay.
Does somebody set this all
Chuck's
up?
Chuck's messing with you.
Chuck.
Yes. The Recreation Department will have a table and a little tent set up for us.
What about our materials?
You bring it. Or people bring it. I bring it, you bring it. It's divided between the commission.
Am I expected to bring anything?
I think the
well,
first
that's
people
what
there
we're
could probably bring.
Because I want to bring some vegetation, so I need to come over.
Drop them at my house.
All right. Do you have some nice containers? Do you have some poster boards for kids?
I'm sure they could put together some poster boards. Yeah.
In the past, we've had to take that tent down.
We won't do that. No, we don't have to do
we
any of that.
We don't do it anymore?
No.
Do we take the materials that we brought back?
You have to bring them back, yeah, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, all right.
The materials, you'll lose.
Mike's here at the end, right?
The very end.
Not right.
Nobody will be in the field, just Mike.
And Mike is our point person.
I am there from 11 to 1.
DPW and the recreation department have his number.
Alan, me.
Well, we're taking our stuff out of here.
We're taking our stuff.
City's taking the tent and the tables and everything. We're not touching that. Just taking whatever we bring to the booth, we're taking ours.
Right, we just take the,
Might wanna bring a chair and let, are they gonna have chairs? Long time.
Bring your own chair.
Yeah.
Hadn't heard of bringing chairs.
Bring your own camp chair.
Chairs and sunglasses and whatever else you need.
Something to drink, 'cause that's, everything's overpriced.
I hear the turtle showing up.
What?
I saw Will here, we should've grabbed it.
What did you say?
The turtle?
That I heard the turtle is showing up.
Good.
I'll bring the turtle.
You know, my wife has watched a couple of meeting videos talk about that. We actually have a pet tortoise. And she's like, you gotta tell him that. Stop trashing the turtle.
It's not that I feel so bad for the turtle.
So I have some hand.
Remember that scene in Breaking Bad? Did you watch Breaking Bad?
No.
I watched it, yeah.
You know the tortoise scene, don't you?
What with the tortoise scene?
Tortoise came out with the head of that drug deal.
Oh, yeah.
Did you see it? That's bad.
So as you all know, Garden in the Woods provided a nice, healthy button bush. While I was there in the bookstore, I couldn't help it. I picked up this small, great natives for tough places. I thought maybe we could give this book away as well. Wasn't that much.
They also have one that I have that I haven't been able to find, similar to that, but it's on invasives.
They had a number of invasives, so I grabbed from them basically, you know, brochures for the place, because I promised Garden in the Woods, since they donated a nice shrub that
was like a $30-$40 shrub.
Yeah, it was. Yeah.
Nice.
And they said we'll give you something about invasive plants. Well, it's two particular things here.
How many of those do we have? Just those two?
That's it.
Can we make copies?
I thought the Envirothon, the high schoolers, were their mission as part of the Envirothon was to make a natives brochure. Did they?
I can check, but I haven't received an email about that yet.
Iris.
Okay. I just think that would be great that we could showcase, you know, that, you know, a high school group came to us and wanted to contribute, and
Norway maple.
Almost like that, you remember the open space guide that Grace did?
Yep.
You know, that was fantastic, and that was
That's on our webpage. Does anybody notice that? It's a great thing. Do we have
We
hard
used
copies?
To have books.
Well, the books are pretty much gone. There's probably one in the office still.
It's worth having it there. We don't hand it out, but have it on the table.
Right.
That's a great thing.
It is a great book.
What's the book
about? As a Girl Scout project. Wasn't it just conservation land?
It was all of the town's conservation land.
Oh, all the conservation land.
Yeah.
It kind of describes
it,
gives a guide. One thing, though, and it's our fault, she does not have the rules in there. And if we ever redo it, they should be added. And thanks for sending those, Chuck.
Yeah.
Did everybody get it or just me?
Yeah, no, I got it.
They used to be posted at all the entrances, but they aren't anymore.
Oh, I saw the rules.
And last meeting, we talked about trying to potentially giving out like a free, two-hour event or something at.
Oh yeah,
Terra.
Raffling it off. Yeah.
Do we still want to?
Yeah, let's
do
that.
He doesn't want to do it.
No, that's fine. I can do that. I can make some sort of like certificate up, and we could take care of that.
Yeah, that'd be great.
So we pick.
Would it be the same raffle for both the plant and the free time? And first thing we draw gets the plant, second thing gets the.
Yeah, great.
Yeah. And then we call them up and say, oh, you won.
Or we use it ourselves.
So are we gonna charge for this raffle?
No. No, we can't do that.
$10.
We need money for Matera.
No, you're gonna do the mutter, so.
Five for eight. Five tickets for $8, the deal.
That's where we're gonna get a mic.
Remember, we're tickets, remember tickets.
I don't think we're authorized to generate revenue outside of fees for our wetland application.
The application actually asks you what you're going to do, and ours is an informational, booth. We're not generating menu.
They're like commercial.
Don't we generate fees from Matera?
We do.
Mm-hmm.
So, I'm sorry.
So who's gonna pay for this free time?
Yeah, I said that incorrectly. Don't we generate profit from Matera or pay for it? We don't.
It pays.
I don't think so.
It doesn't.
Most of it.
But if it was in the ideal scenario, we could.
So actually, if we're raffling off time at Matera, that's legal. We're authorized to do that.
I don't think we should do it. The purpose is to get somebody in there
once
free. And then they'll come back and use it and tell their friends.
Let them in for $5. It's, I mean,
nobody's gonna buy $5.
40 people, 50
no,
people.
No, but let's move on. Sorry.
You guys are against money. You hate money in this sport.
244 Ash Street. They're not ready to come in. They're looking for certificate of compliance, but they're not ready.
Yeah, they actually haven't been. They're still waiting on their occupancy. This was something that I think started 7 years ago, and it's finally being finished up now.
I thought they don't get their occupancy without the certificate of compliance.
They don't, and I'm surprised that their occupancy was held up, because that's usually, you know, doesn't take too long unless there's huge problems. I don't think there's any problems. I just think that they waited 7 years and they just hadn't, it hasn't been issued yet.
Okay. Chuck, do you have any reports, emergency permits, bills?
No bills and no emergency permits, and I don't think at this moment I have any reports. I can tell you about Strawberry Lane may have lost her her extension permit, and we may have
to
sign that.
How long did we give
them?
A year?
Yeah.
Or 30 days?
She misplaced it.
I don't think she ever received it at the post office.
Oh, you mean physically lost it. You don't mean violated it or something.
No, she didn't lose it. She can't find, or she wasn't notified that the certificate of compliance came in the mail, and now it's in that
exception
gray area where it's either coming back to us or still in someone's truck at the post office. I don't know where it's at. So she's asking, if she doesn't receive it soon, we'll be writing it again and sending it to her again. And same date.
Copy that she can come
can't
and pick
we
up.
Just give her
you
a
can't
copy.
Record a copy.
Could it be an original?
Okay,
I have
fine.
I have to give her an original to record, and she's willing to record it.
Are you sure? Okay, all right. We'll do that next meeting.
I'll update you next meeting.
Okay. Minutes for approval, 5/25/16. I see Harry had a couple comments.
Two comments.
Yep. Two. Yeah.
There was just one thing I noticed that we didn't know who voted and.
Oh, yeah.
I don't know who did it. I don't know if anybody had it.
I didn't know the answer.
Was it actually something that we voted on? I think that.
I just remember there were two blanks in there. I can't remember what they were, but I didn't know the answer.
Which one?
Motion to remove the hay at Austin Prep.
Yeah, so it was for Austin Prep.
Additional report next year.
Would we have voted for the Austin Prep one?
I don't remember.
No, that was the certificate of compliance.
Oh, it was. Okay.
No, why would we vote? Because we weren't going to issue it.
Yeah.
Because they were asking for more information.
Did we issue it tonight? I think we did, didn't we?
No, we didn't.
What did we do? Why didn't we?
Because they haven't done anything. They haven't contacted us.
Now I'm remembering.
So I think it was just a discussion. I don't think there was any vote.
Right.
So we can. That was the only thing I saw.
And we're not talking about the tree policy?
Not tonight.
Okay.
But please bring in your questions for next week. Well, Harry asked that we postpone it, or he actually sent it out and said, I won't be here at this meeting. Can we discuss it at the next?
Okay.
Sure. Chuck, so I had some comments.
Can I ask you a quick question? The, I can't remember, I think I don't know, maybe I didn't ask you. A couple weeks ago, there was, we drove by a possible violation, I forget which street it was on now. Tennyson?
Yeah.
Whatever came of that?
Tennyson. So I visited the owner. I didn't make a report on that. So I visited the owner. I went out there. This was the one that Jamie said made a suggestion that we try to contact him before we send him a letter.
Yeah.
So I was driving by, and that we have permitted permitted work on that street, and someone was in the driveway, so I stopped and I went over and I introduced myself, and we ended up walking through the project. It turns out that the back looks like it does because there's a rock, there's a boulder back there just kind of coming up out of the soil, and he's trying to create a retaining wall to just be a bit above that boulder, and he's going to fill it in. But the wetland ends just at the edge of his property. It doesn't go that far. And so the tree work and the work that looks like someone's roughing up the backyard and all that, that's outside the buffer zone.
It's not outside our jurisdiction?
It's completely outside our jurisdiction.
Okay.
Yeah. It's outside the buffer zone. And the buffer zone, to the best of my knowledge, because there's someone else's property, there's two properties still before you get to it, would be clearly about a foot inside his fence, or maybe 5 feet at the most, if you really wanted to do that, you know.
All right. Well, thank you for looking.
He talked about a fence in the future, and he said he'll contact me when he's going to replace the fence on that side, and he was a good guy, you know.
Great. Thanks for going out
there.
Okay. I move we adjourn.
Any second?
I'll second.
All those in favor?
Yeah, I'll second.
See you Saturday. So Mike.